Olá, esta semana o América News vai passar por dois países do Caribe em que a situação política é instável, Cuba e Haiti. Primeiro vamos falar sobre o assassinato do presidente haitiano Jovenel Moïse, que ainda está sendo investigado. A gente discute qual o impacto do crime num país em que as instituições já vêm sofrendo há muito tempo, seja por problemas internos, pela interferência de superpotências como a França e os Estados Unidos, ou por fatalidades como o terremoto de 2010 e, mais recentemente, a pandemia da Covid-19. Eu converso sobre isso com o sociólogo Jean-Eddy Saint-Paul, professor no Brooklyn College, na Universidade da Cidade de Nova York. Ele é haitiano, radicado nos Estados Unidos e conhece como poucos a fragilidade política do país. No segundo bloco, a gente fala sobre Cuba, onde uma onda de protestos vem capturando a opinião pública. Os manifestantes pedem comida, saúde e liberdade. Como explicar essas manifestações? Eu falo com o brasileiro Davi Nemer, que é professor na Universidade de Virgínia e passou muito tempo em Cuba estudando a chegada da internet à ilha. Na tentativa de entender os protestos, além do embargo econômico dos Estados Unidos, da pandemia e do fim do comando da família Castro, as redes sociais também entram na equação. Então, meu primeiro entrevistado é o professor Jean-Eddy Saint-Paul, que vai falar sobre esse assunto. Hi, professor. Thank you so much for joining us today, for sharing with us your expertise on the topic. So, just to begin this conversation, you said in multiple interviews about what's going on in Haiti at this point. It's a coup. A coup is going on in Haiti. So, who is ruling Haiti right now? What is the situation? How grave is this in comparison to the inheritance of fragile institutions in Haiti?
Mila, very glad to be on your show. Who is ruling Haiti now is there is a struggle for power in Haiti. So there is a political vacuum in Haiti. There is a guy whose name is Claude Joseph. He was a former prime minister ad interim under the administration of Jovenel Moïse. But Jovenel Moïse, before he got assassinated, he lost confidence in Claude Joseph. And Jovenel Moïse, President Jovenel Moïse, he nominated Dr. Ariel Henry.
We know that Americans are implicated, have been implicated. A Haitian doctor based in Florida was implicated. Colombians have been implicated. So can you trace foreign relations, not in relationship with this assassination in particular, but with Haiti? And I know that to do that, you would have to go back at least to 1803. But can you briefly explain to us why foreign interference is so important for us to understand the full picture here?
Okay, Mila, for your audience needs to know that Haiti, there has been always, since the very inception of Haiti as a country, there has been an international complot, there has been an international war against Haiti because of the Haitian independence, challenge racism, challenge slavery, and challenge colonialism. So the colonial power of the Western Hemisphere never accepted as a fact the Haitian Revolution. So since then, there has been like that international foreign intervention in Haiti. So one fact was the fact that in 1825, France coerced Haitian people to pay $21 billion for the recognition of their independence.
The equivalent to $21 billion today, right? 150 yes. million francs at the time.
Yes, and then between 1915 and 1934, in the mark of the, in the context of the application of the Monroe Doctrine that stipulated America for American, Haiti suffered a US occupation. And one of the first moves of the US was to change the constitution that foreigner can own land in Haiti. The US elected official also, they went directly to the National Bank of Haiti and they take the reserve gold of Haiti, and the reserve gold of Haiti was transferred to the National City Bank and Bridge Wall Street. And more recently, in 2004, for instance, the Haitian president, democratic elected Jean-Bertrand Aristide, because in 2003, he claimed to France to pay back those $21 billion. So a coup engineer in Washington and Paris overthrown a Haitian president. So you can see since 1804, there has been a struggle for Haitian people to keep their sovereignty. Haitian people have been constantly struggling against imperialism and against in order to preserve their sovereignty.
That's a very important part of it. And it's also very important to acknowledge that Haitian people have been fighting against all those issues. Not only that, but against, in some cases, the ways foreign aid presents itself for Haiti and so many other things. And yet, lately in the past few years, we have seen a sort of disinterest by the population in politics. People are not going to vote, are not participating enough. Can you trace the beginning of that? Is it connected? Because we saw from the outside Michel Martelly's election as a very strong sign of this new face of like, we can't fight anymore, nothing works, we give up. Is this the feeling in Haiti now?
We have to also place that in a more global context. If we overview scrutinize election in Latin America and in the global south, we will see like the eruption of the outsider in politics. So for instance, Joseph Michel Martelly was an outsider of politics. So, and you see that he received the support of Hillary Rodham Clinton, who was then U.S. Secretary of State under the administration of Barack Obama. So, like, it's because Haitian people did not go out to vote because there has been disconnection between the elite and the masses. So people, it's not they lost interest in politics, it's not they lost interest in democracy, but they don't express sympathy for the way that outsider, you know, with the support of powerful nation in the West, you know, they have been leading the country. But in Haiti also, we have a very strong civil society that has been always pushing back, you know, but oftentimes the mainstream media do not cover the fight back of the civil society. But we have a very strong civil society that young folk, young professionals that have been pushing back against any sort of political corruption and asking to hold accountable all those corrupted politicians, including the Joseph Michel Martelly.
That's great. So to end, Professor, can you talk a little bit about internal issues, internal affairs and domestic problems? Like, we know there are issues with violence and gangs and now COVID, and many of these have been pointed as culprits for the current crisis. But there's also one layer there with Jovenel Moïse's new agenda, for the lack of a better word for that. We're talking about a very wealthy man known as Banana Man because owned banana plantations, his family owned banana plantations, but recently has shaped his politics towards taxation of wealth and things like that. So can you talk a little bit about all of those internal affairs, like taxation of the wealth, COVID? What does it have to do with the current situation?
Yeah, actually, this is a very interesting topic. And to understand that, we have to understand that, to bear in mind, in Haiti, Haiti is run by an oligarchy. And oligarchy, if we define an oligarchy sociologically, an oligarchy is, when you have the wealth of a population distributed, that wealth is among few hands. So despite the fact that Haiti represents historically blackness, but Haiti is a system society that works according to anti-blackness. What I'm saying we have anti-blackness in Haiti is because we Haitian, we are 99% of the population that is black skin. But guess what? The economy, the wealth is distributed, is concentrated among 26 hands, 26 oligarchic family. The problem, and it was one of the possible cause for the assassination of Jovenel Moïse, he got into power with the help of the oligarchy. But when he start trying to hold some prominent member of that oligarchy accountable, you know, people who manage the electricity, people who manage everything. So he received many death threats. So the problem in Haiti, the economy is like we black people, 99% of the population, we don't own Haiti. Haiti is owned by foreigners who are mostly light-skinned, mulattoes, you know, people from of Arabic descent, of Jewish descent. So Haitian people, we are like 99% of the population. They treat us every day as strangers in our own land, the land that Jean-Jacques Dessalines, you know, they sacrifice to give us as a legacy.
Professor, thank you so much, Genedy Sampol. It was a great talking to you, and you explained so many things to us. So I appreciate your time and your generosity joining us today.
My pleasure.
Thank you so much. No próximo bloco, eu volto com outro professor, Davi Nemer, dá aulas na Universidade de Virgínia e é especializado em Cuba, onde os protestos capturaram a opinião pública. Mas o que está por trás deles? É a crise econômica? É a pandemia? É a chegada da internet? É a ausência da democracia? A gente vai falar sobre tudo isso depois do intervalo.